Hello, it's me, Lily, a frog who lives in a pond and loves to tell stories. In the Sweetwater Kingdom, there was an old mill on the banks of the river. The mill had a huge wooden mill wheel which sat in the tumbling sweet waters of the river, which pushed and turned the wooden wheel as the river rushed through it on its way over rocks and past fern-studded mud banks. As the churning mill wheel turned the gears and shafts inside the old mill, the great millstone turned too, which ground flour and polished barley and shelled oats. The old miller inside the old mill worked the sluice wheel and the hoppers and buckets, and he commanded a team of boys who hefted sacks of wheat and barley and oats up and down the river banks, and they loaded sacks of flour and refined pot barley and stone ground oatmeal onto wagons pulled by mules. And then the mill boys drove those mules and those wagons up and down the Sweetwater Valley to make deliveries to whomever had their grains milled at the old mill. One day the old miller told the boys who worked for him, "I am old, and I have no wife nor children to pass my mill on to when I retire. It's just you boys, and I want to retire. In the winter I want to sit behind the stove keeping warm and reading books, and in the summer I want to ride to town on a very fine horse. So I have decided we will have a contest. You may set out, and whichever one of you boys brings me the finest horse can have my mill and be the milliner here. All I ask in return is that you care for me while I sit behind the stove, and that you help me feed and groom and saddle my very fine horse for the rest of my days." There were three mill boys who wanted the mill very much so they could be assured a good living from it, and they agreed to the contest. But two of the boys resented the third boy, who they teased and bullied and called Stupid Hans. When he wasn't looking, they wrote "dunce" on Hans's hat. They decided that no matter what, they'd make sure one of them got the mill instead of Stupid Hans, the dunce, as they called him. Well, they came up with a plan to make it appear that they'd all work together. But really, their plan was to work together against Hans. "Let's set out together," the boys said. "We'll hike to the Crystal Caves and we'll sleep there overnight, and then in the morning we'll continue on together." Hans agreed to this, but what he didn't know was that the mill boys were not leading him to the Crystal Caves, and that, in fact, they planned to abandon him in an enchanted forest while he slept so that he'd awake, lost, and alone. When the sun rose and Hans woke up, he was lying in a deep cavern. He looked around on every side and he exclaimed, "Where am I?" Then he got up and clambered out of the cave, went into the forest and thought, "Here I am, all alone and deserted. How ever will I find my way back to the old mill? Never mind finding a very fine horse to bring back with me. All is lost, and so am I." Whilst he was thus walking, full of thought, he met a small tabby cat, which said quite kindly,
"Hans, where are you going?"
"Alas, you cannot help me," Hans told the cat.
"But I can,"
said the cat.
"I know your desire. You wish to have a beautiful horse. Come with me and be my faithful servant for 7 years, beginning tomorrow, and then I will give you a horse more beautiful than any you have ever seen in your whole entire life."
"Well, this is strange, a talking cat," thought Hans. "Either I have been enchanted, or I am in an enchanted forest with an enchanted cat. But as long as I am a stranger in this strange forest, I might as well see if this cat is telling me the truth." Hans was, after all, a trusting boy, and without other options that he could think of. And the cat had kind golden eyes and a sweet purr. The cat led Hans to an enchanted cat castle, where all the servants were kittens. There were kittens that let down a drawbridge, And there were kittens that swung open the doors to the castle. There were kittens that bowed down low to the tabby with the kind golden eyes and who rushed to her with a silver bowl of water and a fish head on a fine china plate.
This is Hans, and he will be our servant for 7 years.
The kittens meowed their approval, for Hans was a capable-looking boy with strong muscles from heaving heavy sacks of flour and oats onto wagons. And moreover, he had kind eyes, too. The kittens were joyful and playful, and they brought Hans fish on a plate, too, and they showed him to a bed just big enough for him. At night, they tugged off his socks for him, and they kneaded his pillow, and they warmed his mattress, and they blew out his candle, and they purred all around him as he slept. In the morning, kittens helped him out of bed and brought Hans his socks and shoes, and one kitten washed his face and another dried his face with her tail. "That feels very soft," said Hans. "Thank you." Then Hans found out how the tabby wanted him to serve her, which was mostly chopping wood, because, as I'm sure you can imagine, chopping wood is a very difficult task for kittens, and it takes a lot of wood to heat a castle. The tabby gave Hans an axe of silver, and a wedge, and a saw of silver too, and a copper mallet, and with these tools he chopped the wood very small for the tiny kitten stoves and fireplaces throughout the castle, and as time went on, he came to stockpile the castle to the roof with finely chopped wood for their fires. In the enchanted cat castle, Hans always had good meat and drink, but he never saw anyone but the tabby cat and her servants. But they were merry enough. After the evening meal each night, three kittens would get their kitten instruments. One played the bass viol, the other the fiddle, and the third, a green-eyed kitten, blew on a trumpet with puffed-out kitten cheeks. The other kittens would sing or dance till it was time to sleep. Once not a stick more of wood could fit in the castle, the tabby gave Hans a silver scythe and a gold whetstone to sharpen it with, and told him to go thither and to mow the grass all around the castle. He did, and he trimmed all the trees too, so that the castle grounds were tidy and beautiful, and then he pruned the rose bushes so that they sprang into full bloom, and the enchanted castle smelled of white and red and pink and purple and yellow roses. "Is there something more you require of me?" asked Hans.
"Yes,"
said the tabby cat.
"Take these silver tools, a carpenter's axe square, and anything else you might need, all of silver, and this silver timber, and build me a small house."
So Hans built the small house and added some pretty details: a wide window that overlooked an enchanted lake where one could watch trout leap and the sun rise and set, and hardwood floors that gleamed like a ballroom, and a little water spout fed by the quick stream, and a clever little mill wheel outside that Hans designed so that there would always be fresh water for the kittens. The kittens were delighted, and the tabby cat purred. The cat asked Hans if he would like to see her horses now, for 7 years had gone by, though Hans could hardly believe it. "Yes," said Hans. Then she opened the door of the small house, and when she had opened it, there stood 12 horses, such horses, so bright and shining, that his heart rejoiced at the sight of them. And now she gave him to eat and drink and said,
"Go home. I will not give you your horse now, but in 3 days' time, I will follow you and bring it."
So Hans set out, with the tabby cat showing him the way back to the old mill. In the 7 years, though, Hans had not once been given a new coat or trousers, and so he had been obliged to keep on his dirty old smock, which he had brought with him, and which, during the 7 years, had everywhere become too small for him. It used to reach down past his knees, but now it barely covered him at all. He didn't mind much before, because cats don't wear clothes or care about clothes, but as he walked through the village of men and women and children, he began to notice people staring, and he began to tug at his little smock, trying to pull it down lower. When he reached home, the other two mill boys were there again as well, and each of them certainly had brought a horse with him. It would require a very kind eye to describe either of the horses as fine, however, and it would be difficult to choose as well which one could be described as finer, as one was knock-kneed and the other sway-backed. Both had flies buzzing on and around them and seemed too lazy to flick them away with their muddy, tangled tails. The mill boys, eyeing Hans's tattered clothing and the way his long, strong limbs stuck out of it, asked Hans where his horse was. "It will follow me in 3 days' time." Then they laughed at him and said, "Indeed, stupid Hans, the dunce, where will you get a horse?" "It will be a fine one," said Hans. Then he went to the parlor to sit at the table, for he was hungry and thirsty after days of travel. But the miller said he should not sit down at his table, for Hans's clothes were so ragged and torn and covered in cat hair that the miller would be ashamed of him if anyone came in and saw him in his mill. So they gave Hans a mouthful of food outside, and at night when the old miller and his boys went to rest, they would not let Hans have a bed. And at last he was forced to sleep outside. And as it began to rain, he was forced to creep into the goose house and lie down on a little hard straw next to an angry goose. In the morning when he awoke, the 3 days had passed, and a coach came with 6 horses, and they shone so bright. It was delightful to see them, and a servant, whose green eyes and puffy cheeks would strike Hans as familiar, led a 7th horse as well, which gleamed with a coat so shiny that it appeared to be made out of silver, and who had white and red and pink and purple and yellow roses braided into his mane and tail. And then a magnificent princess with golden eyes alighted from the coach and went into the mill, and this princess was surely the little tabby cat whom poor Hans had served for 7 years. She asked the miller where the miller's boy with dunce on his cap was. Then the miller said, "We cannot have him here in the mill. He's so ragged. He is lying in the goose house." Then the princess, who introduced herself as the king's daughter, said that they were to bring Hans to her immediately by royal proclamation. So they fetched him from the goose house, and he had to hold his little smock together to cover himself. Then the servants unpacked splendid garments, and they washed Hans with sweet water from the mill stream, and they dressed him. They threw his dunce cap and his little smock in the fire, and when that was done, no king could have looked more handsome than Hans. Then the princess desired to see the horses which the other apprentices had brought home with them, and she saw that one was knock-kneed and the other sway-backed, and she ordered the servant to bring the 7th horse, and when the miller saw it, he said that such a horse as that had never yet entered his yard.
"This one belongs to Hans," said she.
"Then he has won my contest and may have my mill," said the miller. But the princess said that the miller could keep the horse and his mill too, and she asked her faithful Hans to climb into her coach with her and to drive away, and that is what they did. They first drove to the little house which Hans had built with the silver tools, and behold, it had become a great castle, and everything inside it was of silver and gold. And then the princess with the golden eyes, who was in fact a king's daughter, married sweet Hans, and he was rich, so rich that he had enough for all the rest of his life and lived happily ever after.